Hi guys, and thank you for tuning in. If you did not notice it by now, the world is full of conflicts and rivalry. Who is better and what is better? Macintosh or PC? Coke or Pepsi? Chicago Bulls or Los Angeles Lakers? In our small world of emergency medicine, we also have this type of, let's say, rivalry. I can think of at least a couple of examples, but today I want to talk about one. IGEL versus intubation. My name is Alex Heppner, and this is Group Call. When I started my career over 10 years ago in Eastern Europe, there was a massive push towards intubation. So yeah, we were intubating pretty much everyone.
I was riding up my scooter and then I fell down on my elbow.
Jokes aside, this massive push towards intubation was driven mainly by financial reasons. Tubes were cheaper than IGELs? Shame. So let me help you and make your informed choice in 5 easy steps. The first written reports of intubation are dated for 11th century, but the device as we know it was introduced and widely used around 1945. IGEL. This type of device was introduced around 1980 as an easy and effective alternative to the intubation. Since then, many manufacturers introduced their products to the market, like AQ or Oragain, but in this video we're going to focus on IGEL as it seems to be the most popular brand on the market at the moment. The tube is a flexible tube with a left-facing bevel at the tip. On the tip you may find a hole called the Murphy's eye, which is basically a safety mechanism if the distal end of the tube should become obstructed by the wall of the trachea or by touching the carina. Gas flow can still occur via Murphy's eye. Just above the distal end of the tube you may see a tracheal cuff. The cuff is inflated through a spring-loaded valve. Attached to the valve you can see a pilot balloon. ET tubes have several markings on the outside like size, and length. IGEL is a supraglottic airway device made from thermoplastic elastomer. It features a non-inflating cuff with an epiglottic rest, which prevents epiglottis downfolding and airway obstruction, an integral bite block, a gastric channel which provides a mechanism for the management of the regurgitant fluids, and last but not least, a supplementary oxygen port for passive oxygenation. Intubation tube goes here between the vocal cords to the glottic opening and we'll see it approximately here above the carina. If you will push the tube too deeply, you will go to the right bronchi. It's called mainstem intubation and it will result in one lung ventilation. Can it kill your patient? Eventually, yes. IGEL, ladies and gentlemen, doesn't go deep there. It sits nicely here on the top of the glottic opening, creating a nice seal. However, if you will push too harshly, too deeply, you may cause swelling and bleeding to the airway, and it, yes, eventually can kill your patient. Healthcare professionals who like intubation will tell you that it's actually quite quick and easy. You open the patient's mouth, you use the laryngoscope to shuffle the tongue away, you put the tube in, job done. No, it's not that simple. Let's start from the beginning. If you want to intubate, you need to use laryngoscope. And yes, I've heard about blind intubation, finger intubation, and I used to intubate through nose. However, it doesn't change a thing. If you want to think about classic intubation, you need a laryngoscope. Blades. It is a common knowledge that due to the anatomical differences, mainly epiglottis shape and size, you should use a Macintosh blade in adults and Miller blade in peds. However, whilst working on ICU with very knowledgeable anesthetists, I've learned that if you are dealing with challenging airway in adult patients, there's nothing better than large Miller blade. Next thing, to intubate you need either bougie or stylet. And okay, I know, back in the days we used to intubate without those aids, but if you now can reduce the risk of tube misplacement by using those aids, please use them. The differences between bougie and stylet will be covered in separate videos, so I deliberately skip it here. Same with DOPS, MONTS, LEMONS and all those acronyms you use in airway management. Okay, so you have your laryngoscope with a proper blade ready, you have your ET tube with the stylet shaped in the proper way, By the way, I recommend you the gentle hockey stick, but feel free to use any shape you want. Now, you open the patient's mouth and you don't scoop the tongue to the side. Just place the tip of the laryngoscope in the valvula and then control the soft tissues by moving your arm, not the wrist, of course, you know that. You shuffle the tube down the trachea. And my question now is, how deep? Majority of clinicians will tell you 23 centimeters for male patients and 21 centimeters for female. However, it's not that simple. 23-21 rule was derived from one American study published in 1995. Sample was 83 patients, they were all Caucasians, and all males were taller than females. What about a bit more diverse population? What about transgender patients? What about people with unusual height? Well, you have two options. One, use the tube with the markers. As soon as the first black line passes the vocal cords, stop pushing. If you don't have tube with the marker, because they are not really common, you can use mathematical formula called the Chula formula. Chula formula, described in this research, is only for adults. For peds, you have to use different formula. However, it is 0.1 times the patient's height plus 4. For example, for me, I'm 190 centimeters. It is 0.1 times 190, that gives you 19, plus 4, that gives you 23. See, intubation is supposed to be nice, easy and simple, but we didn't finish yet. So the tube is in the trachea, the depth is correct, and now you want to inflate the cuff. And boom, I will stop you here. How many mils of air you inflate the balloon with and why? I'm just asking because it is not really common to see the clinician thinking about the ET tube cuff pressure. And we constantly over-inflating ET tube cuffs. Just please read this research. Overinflation of the ET tube cuff can result in swelling, necrosis, sepsis. Not even mentioning that during the recess, if you will overinflate the ET tube cuff, you may impair the venous flow by increasing intrathoracic pressure. That's really bad. To prove my point, your patient's trachea diameter is approximately 2 centimeters. Now, this is the tube inflated with the correct volume of air. This is the tube inflated with 10 centimeters of air. And this is the tube inflated with 20 centimeters of air. Would you like to have this in your trachea? So, what can we do to inflate the cuff with a proper volume of air? More mature colleagues will tell you, just squeeze the balloon, son. However, now in 2021, we have enough evidence to say that squeezing the balloon won't give you a proper indication of the pressure in the ET tube cuff. Is there anything else we can do? Yes, you can use this or this. This is the device by Ambu. You connect it to the tube. You gently overinflate it to make sure that it has a seal and then just release to the required pressure. It is must-have for every ICU or any clinician. The second option is a true cuff, which is a really light and small device. I think it's a must-have for every pre-hospital clinician. You get some air to the syringe and you inflate the balloon up to the moment when the indicator is on the green field. So here. Oh, that's the correct pressure. Now, eye gel. Firstly, you don't need that much space behind the patient to insert an eye gel than to intubate, and that's good. However, eye gels are weight related, and that's my first worry with supraglottic airway adjuncts. There are at least two big studies on how crap in patients' weight estimation healthcare providers are. Apparently, we can do it properly in approximately 1/3 of the cases. But assuming that you estimated your patient's weight correctly, the insertion is as easy as it can be. So you take the eye gel from the cradle, you squeeze a bit of a gel here, you lubricate the eye gel, you open your patient's airway using the scissors technique, and you shuffle the eye gel in. How deep I should go? Well, majority of clinicians will tell you to the first resistance. However, the first resistance you may feel when eye gel cuff goes between the patient's tonsils. So what I would say, look at the bite block and look at the black line. This black line should be more or less on the level of patient incisors. Just remember that eye gel is easy in application but sits
in the different place that ET-Tube. ET-Tube goes into the trachea and it gives you a good seal. Agile sits on the top of the glottic opening, so it gives you a different seal and protect the airway in a bit different way, if you like. Also, from my experience, Agile can be easily dislodged during the extrication, even if it's properly fixed.
Guys, just use the tube holder. Intubation is too complicated to improvise with bandages, tapes and stuff like that.
If you're lucky enough to have something which is called Agile Resus Pack, you will get this tube holder. So you go from the back of the head. Job done. If you don't have Agile Resus Pack, you can use a bandage. This is so-called two knots technique and it is in the trust I work for. Okay, you may say it is weird, but definitely it does the job. So you start from the back of the neck, go to the top of the Nigel, and you want to make one knot here and you want to make a second knot here. Then you go around the Agile, you make one knot here and a second knot here. And then you go to the back of the neck and you want to have a nice Christmassy bow here. I know it looks weird, it's a British way of fixing an Agile, so I'm just going to leave it here.
Now, before you will turn the video off to pop up something more enjoyable. Give a bit of to me, and I give a bit of to you. Let me just show you something that most likely will bring two rivals together.
So, when you are dealing with a challenging airway, feel free to shuffle an Agile in, and then just push down the ET tube. Bosh! This is called a tracheal intubation through an Agile and been actually tried in Poland by Dr. Wojewódzka Żelaźniakowicz and her team. Effectiveness of the intubation was 93.3%, which I found pretty impressive.
Did we just settle the conflict?
That's it, guys. I hope this video helped you a bit in choosing your favorite way of airway management. Please like and subscribe. My name is Alex Heppner and this was Group Call.